Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the sixth meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee. There are no apologies have been received this morning. And the first agenda item is to agree whether to take item six in private, which is consideration of today's evidence. Are we agreed? Yeah, thank you. The next agenda item is a roundtable discussion on legal aid and legal aid reform. And I refer members to papers two and three. We will take evidence this morning from a round table of witnesses who will be joining us virtually due to social distancing rules at Holyrood. I very much welcome our panel of witnesses this morning. Gillian Fife, Strategic Lead of Strong Communities of the Citizens Advice Scotland. Tony Lenehan, President of the Scottish Criminal Bar Association of the Faculty of Advocates. Mr. Ian Moyer, Legal Aid Convener of the Law Society of Scotland. Mr. David Fraser, Executive Director, Court Operations of the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service. Mr. Colin Lancaster, Chief Executive of the Scottish Legal Aid Board. Ms. Julia McPartlin, President of the Scottish Solicitors Bar Association. Professor Alan Patterson, Professor of Law at the University of Strathclyde. And Dr. Marcia Scott, Chief Executive of Scottish Women's Aid. And we very much appreciate the time that you're taking to join us this morning. I thank those witnesses who've provided a written submission, and these are available online, and I intend to allow around about an hour and 20 minutes for questions and discussion. Please can I ask members to indicate which witness you're directing your remarks to, and then we can open the floor to other witnesses for comments. If other witnesses wish to respond, please can I ask you to indicate that by typing R in the chat function on BlueJeans, and I will bring you in if time permits. If you're merely agreeing with a point being made, there's no need to intervene to say so. Other comments you make in the chat function won't be visible to committee members or recorded, so if you want to make a comment, please do so by requesting to speak. So we'll now move directly to questions. And again, if I can ask members and our invited guests to keep your questions and comments as succinct as possible to facilitate a free-flowing discussion. So I'd like to structure the discussion this morning around a sort of series of broad themes. And the first of those themes is access to justice and the current experiences of users on using the legal aid system. And I would quite like to kick off myself this morning and perhaps direct some opening questions to Professor Alan Patterson and Mr. Ian Moyer. Professor Patterson, I know that you had an advisory role in Martin Evans's review on legal aid, rethinking legal aid back in 2018. And there were some key issues brought out in that report around simplifying the system, creating a sort of fair payment system, and making this system more accessible. So if I can start with you, Professor Patterson, with specific regard to the criminal justice system, I'm quite interested in what priorities you see within that sort of overall idea or theme of accessing legal aid, and how we can improve that in the context of criminal justice going forward.
Thank you, Convener. The primary aim of Evans was to provide a balanced, fair, proportionate access to justice for all, bearing in mind the United Nations Sustainable Development Goal 16.3, which drives us towards access to justice for all in an affordable manner. Evans was well aware of the financial pressures and requests from the profession, but was unable to come up with a single conclusion other than that proper and evidence-based research should be conducted into that. Following that, we have had a payment review panel, which itself has struggled to come to a solution and has recommended more research. In terms of where I would like to see criminal justice itself go, it should become even more people-centred than it currently is, and more of a social or public service. That means that the current legal aid system, which is set up by 1986 legislation, and primarily is a mechanism whereby private lawyers can be paid for delivering the legal aid services that they wish to deliver. It has to change to one that has a focus on the needs of the population and how best to deliver a proportionate service to meet those needs. This will require a change in the role of SLAB and a change in our attitude to legal aid. But in one way, let me point to holism. The current system with judicare or paying case by case does not lend itself to delivering a holistic service to members of the population. So although we know that individuals who come to criminal defence solicitors may have a raft of social and economic and legal problems, the criminal legal aid system is set up only really to deal with their legal problems, when in fact what they need is a one-stop shop, as in New York and Australia and in England and increasingly in other jurisdictions. We're recognising that a holistic approach to the client is required, where you tackle a number of their problems together, hopefully in a one-stop shop.
Thank you very much, Professor Patterson. Mr. Ian Moyer, would you like to come in on that?
Yes, thank you. I think it's fair to say that, having been involved for a number of years with the sort of research that Professor Patterson has referred us to, it's clear that there aren't instant solutions for a lot of the wider strategy that everyone's trying to achieve to improve the system, because it is too complicated at the moment. It's difficult for solicitors of many years' experience to understand the legislative framework because of the way that legal aid has developed over the years, being constrained by the UK Legal Aid Act that underpins everything that we do. So for me, there are two issues here, and I think the profession, broadly speaking, are on board with the idea that simplification and change to the system is welcome, but that that's going to take too long to deal with the immediate crisis that faces legal aid providers. And this isn't a case of us crying wolf about some theoretical problem that might come down the line with the system. At the moment, the courts are gearing up to clear the backlog, and already that is starting to fail. Firms such as myself are finding it really difficult to recruit and retain staff to cover the cases that we have, never mind gearing up to clear the backlog. And already the extra court that was set up in the Borders to clear the criminal backlog has to be scrapped because it was resourced for everybody else, except the problem is there are no defence lawyers to do the cases, so they have simply had to mothball that court. So it's not a theoretical, there may be a problem coming down the line. We are now right in the middle of the crisis that we've been warning about for a long time. And to me, the only solution for that in the short term would be to use the crude tool of a significant increase in the existing legal aid rates while we work on a constructive approach to improving the system in the medium and long term. But that's going to take 2 or 3 years, and we simply don't have that time before there'll be no lawyers or not enough lawyers to carry out the work. So there's an immediate crisis that needs fixed whilst there's still a willingness to work towards a sort of framework that is going to take several years to achieve.
Thanks very much. That's really interesting to hear. A bit concerning in relation to the backlog issues that you've highlighted there. But obviously, from what you've said, one of the challenges is around recruitment, and I know that's something that we've been conscious of. I'll maybe just kind of touch on that briefly for a moment. What do you see are some of the priorities in terms of addressing that? If I can just stay with you, Mr. Moyer.
Yes, I mean, my firm, for example, have been advertising for some time for a criminal assistant and there have been no applications whatsoever. I'm aware of a number of other firms in exactly the same boat. And it's really not a surprise when, quite rightly, COPFS and other Scottish Government solicitors have been given pay rises, which you know they're entitled to, but the starting salary is around £50,000, and there's simply no way that legal aid firms can offer that salary. And then that's before you get to the issue of work-life balance. You know, we're out 24/7, 365, phones going in the middle of the night, clients phoning you at 11 o'clock on a Sunday night to ask what time they're at court next Thursday. That sort of stuff that happens literally every day. So we need to be able to offer pay for quality courts, that sort of thing, to have any chance of recruiting and retaining staff. And we're simply not in a position to do that at the moment. And that's why I'm suggesting that the only immediate fix that's available is a significant rise to the existing fee structure while we work on a more nuanced and suitable way of moving forward in the future.
Thanks very much. I know that we'll be having a look at the kind of fee structure and arrangements in due course, but thanks for that just now. I'll hand over to Russell Findlay if you want to pick up, and then I'll maybe bring in Colette Stevenson after that.
Thank you. This, I suppose, initially is directed towards Ian Moyer, who's already used the phrase cry wolf. Now, the Martin Evans report of 2018 paints a somewhat different picture. It talks about Scotland having the third highest legal aid spend per capita in Europe and funding more cases per 100,000 people than anywhere else in Europe. It refers to the Law Society of Scotland's previous Otterburn report. And Mr. Evans might have been too polite to use the word spin, but he does point out some of the ways this information was presented by the Law Society as being somewhat questionable and selective. Is there not a risk that your doomsday warnings of today are very similar to those that we've heard in the past? And indeed, it's just a question of the market being what it is, and you, again, going back to your point, crying wolf.
I didn't say I was crying wolf. I said I was not crying wolf. And no, this is a totally different scenario whereby we've been warning for years that we're heading to this point. We've now reached it where every week young lawyers are leaving to join the Crown and other government bodies. We cannot get lawyers to conduct trials, which means that going forward, we won't have experienced lawyers to become the sheriffs, judges, senior prosecutors, and so on that we need going forward. So to simply say, ah, well, we can get through today isn't good enough. We need to be in a position where we have a proper access to justice for the people of Scotland. We already have legal aid deserts, vast parts of the country where nobody can access a solicitor. And to say, oh, well, we'll spend less on civil legal aid because nobody's applying, if that's because they can't find somebody to represent them, then that's a very poor thing indeed. And the other point that was made quite clearly about the spend per head, etc., is that we have a totally different adversarial system than many countries in Europe, where the judge is in charge of all of the investigation and the lawyer's role is very limited. Completely different system that we have in Scotland. So it's simply not a straight comparison, and that's been accepted a number of times in the past, and I'm sure Professor Patterson would agree with that.
Going back to the point, nobody's suggesting that there aren't problems in terms of accessing justice, but the blunt tool of more money just seems to be slightly jarring, perhaps. Do you agree with that?
Against a background of decades of falling fee levels. But I started 30 years ago and we're still broadly on the same page in terms of how much we get paid. And yet I've got to pay pensions for my staff. I've got increased overheads year on year. And it's extremely difficult to run a legal aid business, and to simply say, well, you should be willing to prop that up from other income isn't an answer to the need for fair remuneration for the work done, which is what we're statutorily entitled to.
The Law Society of Scotland's Otterburn report, I can quote some of this here if you like. Assumptions appear to have been made in the report and notional calculations used to reach the hourly rate for the purpose of a press release rather than figures provided by respondents. Mr. Evans describes it as an admirable attempt by the Law Society of Scotland to quantify the commercial viability of conducting legal aid work, but he concludes there is no argument or no evidential basis in which to raise fees. Do you just discount the Evans report in its entirety? Do you recognise that picture?
I've already indicated that we are more than happy and have done in the past to engage in a constructive way with the Legal Aid Board and the Scottish Government about a better way of doing things in the future. I think everyone agrees that there are better ways that things could be done. But the point is, since those reports were done, we've had a global pandemic. We've had the courts grind to a complete halt. We've had a massive drop in the amount of money that Legal Aid Board have spent because cases simply weren't concluding. And that's despite, I think the figure is 23% down on the spend last year, and that's despite firms being able to interim fee cases. So there is a massive financial hole. Now, that has been partly recognised by the Scottish Government in the Resilience Fund, which I welcomed. But that doesn't mean that there is not still a massive problem. Like so many other areas, they've been dramatically affected by the pandemic, but we were already on our knees before that. So to look into the past really isn't going to help us solve the immediate crisis or the future. Those were reports that were prepared against a totally different backdrop. And I think what we need to focus on is how do we get through what we face now? And as I said, I'm still more than happy to then look at the basis of those reports as a starting point for further discussion with the government about a better way forward in the long term.
Okay. Very quickly, Professor Patterson, do you believe there's any risk that the previous warnings from the Law Society over many years, and they're a very effective lobbying organisation, will count against them today? It is a case of perhaps crying wolf, or that could be the public perception.
I think the profession are facing a real storm. The demands and of criminal practice has been very clearly made out by Ian Moyer. What is difficult, and what Evans found difficult, and clearly the Payment Review Panel found difficult, is to find the straightforward solution to the financial difficulties. We know that criminal practitioners, criminal legal aid practitioners, specialise, and we know that roughly 60% of legal aid work is done by 25% of firms, so that a lot of firms don't do very much. So if you come across with a straight payment rise, you're running a risk, Evans felt, of over-rewarding the specialists who could be very efficient and cost-effective. And if you were going to raise fees at a level where those who don't do very much legal aid made it cost-effective, maybe I'm obviously oversimplifying. So what we have to find a way is a way of paying criminal legal aid practitioners, which is fair to all. And that is, and we have to look at the health of the market as well. And so in the Netherlands, they're conducting exactly the sort of research the Criminal Review Panel recommended, that we look into both the numbers coming into the profession, the numbers willing and able to do criminal legal aid work, and also how many people are available to provide legal aid. It is true that significant numbers have been leaving the criminal legal aid profession, but what's not clear is whether they're the specialists or those who don't do very much.
Can I ask two more brief questions or move on?
I'd quite like to move things on. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll bring in Colette next and then Pauline McNeill.
Okay, thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Focusing in as well on accessibility to justice, and I wanted to bring in Dr. Marsha Scott regarding your submission from the Scottish Women's Aid. And within your submission, you mentioned something about good examples of good practice. I would like to find out a wee bit more about that, and also about women's the advice or the misadvice on their entitlement to legal aid, and how we can do better, and maybe citizens' advice play a role in that as well. So I would like to hear from you that, if you don't mind. Thanks.
Thanks for that. Absolutely. The submission that we gave to the committee reflected really probably a decade of concerns on the part of the violence against women sector generally, but really particularly Scottish Women's Aid, around the fact that the legal aid model is just not fit for purpose for women and children living with domestic abuse. And I know that it's described as needs-led, but it is also means-tested. And anybody who knows anything about domestic abuse knows that access to family assets and finances in over 94% of domestic abuse cases is restricted by the abuser. So it's just a system that has no logical sense in it. And I'm happy to say that in our discussions with the Law Society, although we may not agree about a number of other things, we certainly agree that, and they agree that domestic abuse is, that the legal aid model is not appropriate for domestic abuse. The good practice models we've done a couple of pieces of work, and I have to say a big thank you to Martin Evans, in part because I thought his review was remarkable, but he also, after interviewing us, helped us get in touch with the Legal Education Foundation in London, and that is where we've been doing this project of gathering data about problems with access to justice. And just as a reminder, you know, domestic abuse is 25% of the police and court business. So this is a really significant issue in the grand scheme of things. And the good practice that we knew about was that there had been what I call the Slab Cab Project, which had been, which was in Stirling and is still operating, I think, and was funded to provide a solicitor, a family law solicitor, to the women involved in Stirling Women's Aid. And this was a number of years ago. The outcomes of those cases were remarkably different from what we were seeing regularly. And that is because the solicitor was hosted by Stirling Women's Aid. She was well-versed in the problems that women would walk in the door with and understood the context of the cases. And really importantly, was able to provide free service early. So, you know, this was an early intervention that looked nothing like what the usual access to justice did. So we really have been interested in expanding our understanding of how that model worked and how it could work if we spread it around Scotland. So that on top of the fact that, I absolutely agree that the issues with access to justice are many and varied and particularly acute from our perspective in our island and rural communities. There's no guarantee that women understand the complex system, that the advice they're being given is given in a way that is nuanced to understand their ability to access finances and safety. And so the system is just remarkably poorly designed for domestic abuse. And one of the things that Martin Evans and we talked about quite a bit was the fact that the regulation, and it is exactly what was being referred to before, about this is a system that privileges private provision. And you can't blame the private, you know, solicitors for using it. But the difficulty is that it establishes regulatory barriers for organizations like ourselves So we're not allowed to hire lawyers, even if we had lots of money to do so, because of the regulation scheme, which protects those jobs for private lawyers. So I do think that we don't want to wait for a nuanced approach. We need a really bold step as far as we're concerned. And
Thank you. It's just so that we can keep the discussion moving on. Do you have a follow-up question?
It was really just to see, you know, your views on whether you think that, you know, based on the evidence that's came forward, if there's a role for non-lawyers to deliver, you know, advice in the criminal legal advice. And again, maybe Citizens and Advice could come in on that quickly as well, just to see what their experience has been in the past of that.
Is that for Gillian or for me?
Do you want to bring in Citizens Advice?
Yes.
Gillian Fife, would you like to come in on that? Ms. Fife, would you like to come in on that?
Sure, thank you. Thank you. I guess, I suppose I'll caveat my comments at the start by saying we don't tend to see a huge amount of criminal cases coming through the Citizens Advice Network. It's more on the civil side. But I suppose we do see that there are challenges and limitations of the current legal system. For a bit of context, from August last year to August this year, the Citizens Advice Network provided over 6,000 pieces of advice to over 4,000 clients on finding a solicitor or advocate. And this has increased by 22% during that time. And also the demand for legal aid, advice on legal aid has gone up by 32% in that time as well. I guess we support an early intervention and prevention approach and making sure people can get early advice and support and access to advice and support to help them resolve their dispute in the way that they think is most appropriate. In terms of access to practitioners across the country, we do see that as a bit of an issue in certain areas and for certain specialities. Ian Moore referred to kind of deserts in terms of provision, and we see similar issues on the civil side, mostly in rural areas, but not just in the Highlands. It stems from the borders to the Highlands, where clients have to search for a solicitor over a wider geographical area, almost sometimes to the central belt, and still not being able to access a practitioner. Which means almost a lot of the time the cases are withdrawn, so the individual can't find the practitioner to take on the case. And obviously the individual Citizens Advice Bureau will support them the best way that they can in terms of advice on time limits or other advice, whether it's on housing or income maximisation or anything like that. But ultimately, if they need a solicitor to carry out the work related to their dispute, if they're not able to find that, then, you know, that's a barrier to them accessing justice. I guess to build on the comments from Women's Aid, we've had specific concerns raised with us from Citizens Advice Bureau in the Highlands area about the abuse. There as well. I suppose the other issue we've seen in terms of good and bad practice is we have some anecdotal evidence of incorrect advice being issued from staff at solicitors' firms in relation to eligibility for legal aid, which obviously doesn't help when someone's trying to dissolve their problem. And in this instance, it was trying to challenge an award payment from the DWP. So those are just some examples, I guess, from our network's perspective. But as I said, the issues we tend to see through the network are more focused on the civil side rather than the criminal side.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Rona Mackay, do you want to come in?
Yes, thank you, Convener. Yeah, it's really just to follow up on the line of questioning my colleague Colette Stevenson, and it's to Dr. Marcia Scott, please. In your submission, you know, some of the barriers that you cite that face women and children experiencing domestic abuse are scarcity of lawyers prepared to take on legal aid cases, a lack of quality and skill, particularly in immigration cases and child contact cases. Can I ask how acute this problem is? And also, I guess these issues have been around a while, but are they getting worse now? And maybe just comment on the scale of it.
Well, on top of the 20 to 25% issue, one out of four women experience domestic and sexual violence in Scotland. The the backlog in court cases at the moment, and this is civil cases for the most part in summary court, but or criminal cases in summary court, is now 40,000. I think I mentioned that last week when we spoke. And we are seeing women vote with their feet around this. So they can't get access to a lawyer that can then help them get access to protective orders if they need them. So it becomes immensely more dangerous to call the police, because the system, with all well-intentioned actors, is not able to respond quickly enough to protect women. The reality that we have is that unless somebody gets makes a really bold move to do something about that court backlog and to make sure that women can access a lawyer and that that lawyer understands domestic abuse, we will lose 20 years of progress, I think, in domestic abuse. Women are losing confidence in the system as we speak. The proposals for how we're going to pull the backlog, deal with the backlog, are simply not going to do the trick. And I am immensely concerned that while we can see the light at the end of the tunnel in terms of a possible model that is affordable and delivers good outcomes, that unless we do something about the backlog in the courts, the women aren't going to be there anymore once we can provide that service.
Thank you. And I think that moves on then to a question for some of our legal experts in the panel.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm going to bring in Mr. Lancaster. I think you were quite keen to come in, and then I'll bring in Ms. Clark and Pauline McNeill. Mr. Lancaster.
Yeah, thank you, convener. Good morning. It was really just picking up on a number of the points that have been discussed already, and I think some of the points that Ian Moir has made and others that Marcia Scott have made, I think highlight things that we've recognised in the system in terms of the bluntness of some of the tools that exist to address particular issues, whether that's particular parts of the country or particular client groups or particular problem types, where we have, if you like, a national system which is a little bit one size fits all. And one of the things that I think Martin Evans picked up in his review, which the government consulted on in their follow-up consultation, and which we certainly commented upon in our response to the consultation, is that the Judicare legal aid system is very reactive. So it's a statutory framework that sets tests for access to a fund, and it's very difficult to direct resources towards particular areas of need, to design services, the sorts of things that Marcia is talking about in terms of either locating solicitors in other services or having them dedicated to providing a service to users of other services, to work with them to secure early intervention, to really design it around their needs and the particular sorts of cases that they have or the circumstances that they experience. All those things are very difficult to do in a Judicare system, which is overwhelmingly directed towards reacting to clients seeking help, passing the test, and having legal aid granted, and then a service delivered in respect of an individual case. So that kind of touches on some of the things that Alan Patterson mentioned about a holistic approach and thinking about how you could design wraparound services where somebody who is seeking help, whether that be from a third sector advice organisation, a support service, or direct from a solicitor, could then get access to the range of services that they might need to meet the needs that they present with. And as I say, the complexity of the Judicare system can be a barrier to access. We've heard about potential confusion around eligibility. It is a complex system. There are people who are eligible but might not think so. And those sorts of things maybe do provide barriers to access in some circumstances. But I think what I would say is that, you know, we recognise that the one size fits all might not always be appropriate where there are particular needs or particular problems. And similarly, a one size solution doesn't necessarily fit those problems. So being able to a general improvement in fee rates, for example, might have an effect, but it wouldn't necessarily direct resources towards or availability of services towards the particular needs that are identified. So that's why in our response to the consultation, we set out a range of models which could include the ability alongside the Judicare system, which generally serves the country well, you could have targeted services where resources could be directed towards particular areas of need, particular problem types, particular parts of the country, and that would ensure the availability of a service in those places or for those people in a way that it's actually very difficult for the Judicare system to ensure.
Thank you, Mr. Lancaster. Katie Clark, do you want to come in?
Yes, I'd like to ask about the role of the Public Defence Solicitor's Office, both in terms of what role it might play in a reformed legal aid system and what the balance would be between, you know, private practice and public sector provisions through, you know, the Public Defence Solicitor's Office, but also in terms of the current crisis and whether there is a role for the Public Defence Solicitor's Office, particularly in busy courts, because it may well be that because of waiting times, etc., there's more efficient ways to deal with the problem, to make sure that solicitors are actually, you know, addressing the tasks that need done in terms of the way that things are organised. And maybe if I could ask Colin Lancaster about that in terms of whether he thinks realistically there is a role for a greater use of the Public Defence Solicitor's Office in the immediate future.
Mr. Lancaster, do you want to come in?
Yes, thank you. I think that's an interesting question, which is in two parts. So you've got the current position and then the future position. At present, we have 25, 26 public defenders around the country. That sits alongside over 900 private sector solicitors. So you can immediately get that sense of scale there and in terms of the impact that those solicitors are or would be able to have in relation to any particular issues. It's quite locally focused. On the areas where they operate. They don't operate in all the courts in Scotland. So I suppose what I would say is that they certainly make a contribution. They are busy, they deliver high quality services alongside their peers in private practice. So yes, they are available as duty solicitors in all the courts they operate, and they provide that cover effectively. But as I say, the scale is just very different when you compare them to private practice. In terms of a reformed system, again, in our response to the consultation, we suggested that there could be a variety of different models for delivering, well, all legal services, but we're talking about criminal today. So yes, there are a variety of potential models, both for funding and delivering those services. At the moment, we have the case-by-case funding system for private practice, and we have the PDSO. But what we were suggesting was there might be a range of other ways in which you could either blend those services or add to them with other forms of funding, whether that would be grants, commission services, contract services, again, to try and secure the availability of a service in particular places at particular times or for particular parts of the service. So, for example, for police station advice or for custody court duty or for sexual offences, or, you know, there might be specific things where it might be worth, you know, targeting a bit of investment, and PDSO can certainly play a part in that kind of mix. I think in our submission for this morning's meeting, we touched on a few potential areas in which the criminal justice system and the criminal legal aid system could evolve. And again, this picks up on something that Alan Paterson said earlier about holistic advice and really trying to think about how you can harness the great work that the criminal defence agents already do, but are also potentially able to do in terms of the difference that they can make to their clients' wider problems. PDSO has huge potential to be a testing ground for those kind of approaches. It's not something we've done a huge amount of. Very much the model has been to try and mirror the private practice approach as closely as possible and really focus on delivering traditional defence services in a traditional way. But I think there's great scope for looking at how emerging needs could be addressed, maybe use the PDSO to test ideas, to work in partnership with other agencies, whether that be third sector or other public agencies or with the private sector providers, establish how things can be done, maybe establish the costs, maybe help us work out how much it would cost and how we would best pay for some of those things so that that can then be rolled out more broadly and bring in the private sector to that. And one idea that we've been discussing over the last few months is in relation to independent legal representation for complainers in sexual offence cases, which is one of the things that Lady Doreen's review touched on. And we've been exploring a little bit with Rape Crisis Scotland, whether there could be a role for defence agents in that, and whether we could test that out with PDSO, with a view to then rolling it out more broadly. So hopefully that answers both sides of your question.
I mean, just very briefly, I mean, given the current crisis, though, are you expanding, you know, the Public Defence Solicitor's Office at the moment? Are you recruiting? And how does pay compare to solicitors such as Ian Moir was discussing in private practice?
The way we are set up at the moment with PDSO is that we have a kind of a general size limit on the operation. So we only operate in certain places, and we're not generally authorised to expand PDSO beyond, you know, roughly the size it is at present. So if that was a thing that the ministers wanted us to do, then certainly we could look to either expanding into other areas or bringing in additional solicitors to the offices we already have. But at the moment, any recruitment that we're doing is really to provide cover for maternities, etc. So it's, as I say, it's a relatively small operation, mm-hmm. And you know, it's been kept at that level for many years now. It's been roughly that size for the last decade. So there are no immediate plans for expansion then, because we haven't been asked to do so. In terms of the pay question, this is really quite a difficult one for us to answer, because while we know about and the pay scales for public defenders are public, and you know, when we recruit, we publish the pay scales there. We don't actually have very good or really any information at all about what private sector solicitors are paid. I know that there are various recruitments underway at the moment. I know that the traineeship posts that have been advertised, partly funded by the government's traineeship fund, have been massively oversubscribed, and there are recommended rates for trainees. What we don't know is how much qualified assistants are paid in private practice firms. We don't know what the drawings of partners might be. So in terms of any debate or discussion about pay levels, there's really a lack of information on which to base any comparisons or to really understand the dynamics of the situation. So that's something I really can't answer.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Ms McNeill, would you like to come in?
Thank you very much, convener. So the themes of my question is just a continuation of what you've heard so far. I'm interested in the impact of the quality of justice, given what we've just heard, and also want to talk to Colin Lancaster about the system and early pleas. If I could start with Ian Moir and ask, so we've heard so far about the number of practices which are leaving, and you've outlined to the committee competing with recruitment in other places, such as the government recruiting lawyers and the gap in pay. But you talked about the work-life balance of criminal legal aid solicitors. I just wondered if you could just say a bit more about that. Is that a primary reason why we're losing solicitors to legal aid defence?
I think there's very much that's the case, and in particular I think Edinburgh has been probably the worst affected jurisdiction in terms of the impact of young women in particular leaving this area of work, because the work-life balance is so off-kilter. I mean, during COP26 there are going to be courts running 7 days a week for 3 full weeks. We can be called out literally any day of the year, Christmas Day, New Year's Day, to go to a police station to represent a vulnerable person or somebody facing a serious charge. And then you could be out half the night doing that sort of work and then be trying to be fresh to run a jury trial the next day. And the sort of people that I'm talking about that we're seeing leaving in droves at the moment are the people probably between 2 and 10 years qualified, who are getting to the stage where do a difficult jury trial. You know, it's all very well saying there are X number of solicitors on the Criminal Legal Aid Register, they have to be of a sufficient level of experience to provide a quality service. And up till now, that's always been the case in every survey that's been done. And Colin Lancaster has recognised this morning that traditionally the Judicare system with private practitioners has delivered an extremely high standard for the people of Scotland. And nobody wants to see that diminished. But the reality is many of the people that are on that register don't practice on a regular basis. Some of them are not even in practice anymore at all. Some of them have left some time ago. There are even people, I'm afraid to say, on it who are deceased now. So we don't have a true figure for exactly how many people have the required level of experience and expertise to go to court every day and be at their best and provide the quality service that everyone wants to be provided. But the reality is those of us that are left are being put under increasing pressure week by week. The situation's getting worse in terms of trying to cover the courts, and that's before the programme of recovery is fully up and running. So I really can't overstate just how difficult it's going to be over the next year or two for us to get through this if we can't recruit more people to help us. Now, the trainee fund is something that I was passionate about and fought hard for, and I'm delighted to see that it's come in, and I'm delighted that there are 40 trainees. My firm have taken one of those trainees and another trainee that we're funding fully ourselves in the hope that we can try and have them appearing in court in the relatively near future. But we will be responsible, as will all the other firms. We're not going to suddenly throw these people in to do stuff that's way beyond their ability. So there is a limit to what they can do to help.
Yeah. Thank you. I mean, that's quite an important point I want to come to, and I was going to ask Tony Lenehan maybe to speak to that in terms of your submission about, so I notice from your submission you mentioned the recent was it boycott, Gowns Down campaign, and we've heard from Ian Moyer about, you know, the importance of the experience of lawyers. I wondered if Tony Lenehan could give me a response to whether he thinks choosing a solicitor and having a solicitor of experience is important for the quality of justice. And do you have any fears that if we don't, and I do note the progress that has been made, I think it has to be said, do you have concerns about the quality of justice if we don't find a solution to this in the short term?
Yes, good morning. I wondered whether, listening to what the discussion earlier on about the current crisis, which Ian Moyer explains, what the thing that makes it a real difficulty just now is that all of the plants surrounding criminal defence private practice are being watered, in the sense that, you know, the Crown have uplifts in their pay scales and all of that sort of thing, same with the Scottish Government, as I understand it. And that's the big difficulty which makes it a focus just now, and that's why people are leaving, because there are simply more attractive pastures being created round about it. From my point of view, when I was a solicitor in private practice, I had, I suppose, a fairly limited view because I could see the people that surrounded me in that jurisdiction. What happens now is that I'm instructed by people all over the country, and it lets me see a very wide variety of instructing solicitors. And the quality of the instructing solicitor, even though I am the person who speaks in court by the time it comes to the High Court, the quality of instructing solicitor is enormously important. Even going back to what Professor Patterson said, you have some solicitors who have a real sense of their ability to make changes in the lives of vulnerable and damaged people. Increasingly, what I see is that I am instructed in cases by people who are much less senior than they used to be. So the situation where I had people who were 20, 30 years experienced coming to court with me, giving real weight and benefit to the role that they fulfil in instructing solicitor in the High Court, that's very much dropped away, very much dropped away. The situation now is that most often people are sent into the High Court at a much earlier stage in their career, and it reduces, sometimes to the point almost of nil, the assistance that they provide to the process of the trial in the High Court. So I can't tell you more about working in solicitors' offices, because I'm a number of decades removed from that. But I do see a real drop in the people who are coming to instruct in the High Court, and that has a real effect on my ability and my colleagues' ability, whether advocates or solicitor advocates, to provide the best service to those who are in the greatest need of it. So I see what is being spoken about, and I hear about the difficulties from every point of the compass.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I just had a last question to Colin Lancaster, and it's on. So, according to the SSBA Bar Association, they say that the current system legally does not conducive to early resolution of cases. There are significant gaps in funding available at early stages in the process, and the system fails to adequately recognise the preparation and responsibility involved in negotiating early pleas. I just wondered do you agree with that statement, and is there an issue about a better system where there was earlier payment to ensure that there would be early pleas? After all, I guess that's what you'd want in any court system. Thank you.
Yes, absolutely. I do agree with that point. The way the fees work at present for solemn cases is that the work tends to be quite backloaded in a case, and that's the way the payments work. We had a range of discussions with the Law Society several years ago on the back of discussions that the Society had with their members. And one of the priorities that emerged from that was to try and improve the way in which the fee structure recognised the value of early preparation, and particularly where that led to early resolution of the case. We then drew those principles into some proposals, and we discussed those a series of roadshows with the profession back in 2017, and they were quite well received at that time. The point we're talking about here is where a case is resolved by way of what's called a Section 76 indictment. And that effectively brings the proceedings to a conclusion by way of an agreed plea in solemn cases before the case is then proceeding on to trial. And the structure that we proposed would have included a fairly significant block fee, which would allow for the preparation at that early stage, for the consideration of the evidence, for engagement with the Crown with a view to negotiating a Section 76 conclusion, and then that would be paid for as that single block. So, as I say, that was well received. Those fee proposals were shared with the profession again last autumn as part of the discussions around some of the support requests in response to the pandemic, because it was viewed that actually putting in place those reformed fees, although it wouldn't have an immediate impact, it would result potentially in more cases resolving at that earlier stage, resulting in better payment earlier on for solicitors, and particularly in light of the backlogs that even at that time we could see were building. And there has been a growth in solemn cases over the last year. That could have had a very significant impact. I think it's fair to say that the emotions are running high at that time, at the point that those proposals were shared. The profession were fairly clear in their view that they didn't think then was the time to introduce them. So regulations were not brought forward to introduce those reforms. But discussions with the government have continued, and I know that just in the last week or so, the Scottish Solicitors Bar Association and the Law Society have met with the government to consider those proposals again. We're very, very keen to see them move forward for a number of reasons, primarily because of the position in relation to early resolution, but also we think that that structure would hugely simplify what is a complex fee structure. It can be very time-consuming and complicated for solicitors to frame their accounts. They're complicated to assess. They can result in disputes between us and the profession, and we think moving towards that block structure that better rewards early preparation would be a winner all round. So we're really keen to see that move forward.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I know, Mr. Lennon, you would like to come back in. Before I ask you to come in, I'd like to bring in Ms. McPartlin. I'm aware that you supported the written submission. So if you would like to come in, then Mr. Lennon, and then I'll bring in Mr. Green.
Yes, thank you. Just in terms of fee reform, I think it's important to say that we do recognise that that's necessary. The comments in my submissions about the legal aid system at the moment and not being conducive to early resolution of cases, I think is important, obviously, for the backlog. Part of the problem, I think, that the profession has had with agreeing the proposed reforms that have been suggested by SLAB is that they were initially designed to be cost neutral. So whilst we do want to see perhaps increased fees for Section 76 pleas, etc., we don't want that to be at the expense of work further down the line. And I think there's probably some concern that if the system is front-loaded at the expense of fees for sheriff and jury trials, that also leads to an imbalance. So we're happy to keep working on that with the Scottish Government, and as Dr. Lancaster says, we are engaging with that, but we recognise that those are problems at the moment. I think there was raised earlier about the quality of solicitors that we will have in the profession if current trends continue. I think we very much welcome the traineeship fund, but it doesn't address retention of staff. And at the moment, I think perhaps the biggest challenge is that with Procurator Fiscal Service having a recruitment drive, the obvious place to recruit qualified solicitors who work in the criminal sphere is from the defence. And so we're really missing out on people who have experience, because we can't compete with the wages that are offered literally across the table from us.
Thank you very much. If I can bring in Mr. Lenhan, if you can make your comments as brief as possible, and then I'll bring in Mr. Green. Thank you.
It's really just, first of all, I recognise there are so many benefits to early resolution that is a goal that we should strive towards. But my experience, this is just a word of caution, is that the people who are involved in the criminal justice system very often are poor decision makers who take short-term decisions. And so frequently I come across cases where there is no doubt that early resolution makes sense, but they would rather take a decision which allows an extra 3 months on bail or seeing Christmas out or whatever. So it's really just to bring about a note of caution. It is very good that we strive towards early resolution in cases, because that brings dividends in every direction in terms of policing and court time and everything else. The reality I have found over the years, and this is a matter that has arisen in various post-COVID working groups, you know, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make it drink. And the people who are involved in the criminal justice system very often are very poor decision takers, and it's hard to let them see the benefits for them of that. So it was really just that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Mr. Green.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. We've covered a lot of ground already. I don't want to risk going back to revisit some of that, but there might be some crossover in my questions that mean we do go back a bit. Just going back to this so-called crisis in the profession, and that's a phrase used by the Scottish Solicitors Bar Association, so perhaps my comments and questions are directed at Ms. McPartlin in the first instance. You do use the phrase that the profession is in crisis, and I'd like you to just elaborate a little bit on that. I'm sure some of it will echo what Mr. Moyer has already said, but is it the case, and just to get to the nub of it, that the reason it's in crisis is twofold? One is you're struggling to recruit new entrants to the market, and the time that it takes to get them up to speed to be able to handle the levels of cases that is required of them, and that there's churn and that you're losing people at the halfway through their career, even in early stages of the career, to other parts of the legal sector. Now, one of the suggestions made is that the increase in legal aid will be a short-term fix to that. I'm not convinced I've actually heard the evidence or the argument as to the connection, and maybe someone could help me with that, because I don't see the direct link between the immediate raise of fees and the solving of the problem of churn. So perhaps that's something you could expand on, but just, you know, why do you think there is such a crisis in the profession?
Anyone?
Thank you. Well, I think we have to go back because we've got a history of underfunding. So these are warnings that have been given by the Law Society and local bar associations that have been going on for, I think it's probably not an exaggeration to say, decades. And that, I suppose, has led to a sort of slow drip of people moving away from the profession to other areas where they may have better paying conditions. And it means that firms operating in criminal legal aid aren't able to offer as competitive packages to attract new solicitors. But what I think sort of compounds that problem, that's been going on for some time, but we're now seeing a situation where funds are being put into the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, I mean, rightly so, to try and attract new staff there with a view to tackling the backlog. And there's suddenly a recruitment drive which better paying conditions are being offered. So people who are in criminal defence look at what's being offered at the fiscals, and they're effectively, people that work in criminal defence are very well placed in terms of their existing experience and qualification to go and work for the Crown. And we would normally see people going back and forth as a normal sort of career progression, but we're seeing a drain away rather than swapping staff as it maybe was in the past. So the reason that we say that an increase would be a quick fix is that it would address this the underfunding that's gone on for decades, so that we can get money back into defence quickly as possible. So essentially we're talking about an equivalent to the extra funds that are going to Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, which would allow us to pay our staff more so that we can compete with the salaries that are offered by those sitting across the table from us.
Okay.
I have to say, I don't think that that people don't want to do the job, because we've seen with the traineeship fund that lots of people have applied, and we hear all the time about people it's an interesting line of work. People do want to do it. And I know that from people that have left, that they said that they enjoyed the job and it was really more financial concerns that were the issue. So it's really the retention of staff, I think, rather than getting people in the first place.
Yeah, and thank you for that helpful update. I mean, I guess the bit I was trying to make the link in is this, you know, this blunt tool that we're talking about of if we increase the legal aid fees, that will somehow magic cash into your businesses, because that's the nature of the majority of your work, I presume, is the assumption. And therefore, the either the amount of work has to increase or the amount of fee per job increases. And it's one of those has to be true. Is that because of the nature of the type of work that defence is, that therefore is so much more reliant on the subsidy? Because effectively, legal aid is a subsidy to the profession rather than to the consumer.
Yeah, so I mean, looking at the sort of statistics at how many firms are doing legal aid, I mean, the majority of I would say, I guess, sort of proper criminal legal aid funds, that will be all that they do, because it takes up all your time. You'll be in court the whole time. We don't have the capacity to do more work than we're already doing, because with the fees over the years haven't been increased, people take on more and more work in order to make things financially viable. So that, I think, probably can't change. But I think it's important to understand that that the fees have remained static. I mean, there have been sort of tweaks here and there, but they've been static for such a long time that they in effect have decreased if you start taking into account things like inflation. So we can't increase the amount of work we do. We're at capacity already. So the only other way to inject more money into firms is to increase the fee that we get paid.
Right, which I guess raises a sort of right fundamental and philosophical question as to whether the public purse should be subsidising private defence
solicitors. But that's a whole other conversation, well, you're not, I'm sure.
I mean, legal aid is being provided as a service to the public, and if we want, and I think as a society, we should offer representation to people who are being accused of crimes, particularly serious crimes, by the state. And I mean, that as a principle, I think is already well established, but it's how much you value the work that we do in providing the defence. I'm not sure it's right to look at it as a sort of public-private issue. I think in society, we need to have independent defence solicitors in order to represent people. I mean, you're talking about representing people against the state, so it would make sense to do that. But at the moment, I mean, what we're seeing is that the pay that is made for the work that is done by private firms, and it doesn't reflect the complexity, it doesn't reflect the expertise. The rates fixed haven't changed with inflation. These are really outdated rates that are being paid to us.
Thank you. And it sounds like the Legal Aid Payment Review Panel, which reported to government earlier this year, hasn't gone down well with you either. You say that it's failed to produce any meaningful results. I know there was actually a government-initiated question in the Parliament today from the Minister for Community Safety that says that they accept that more consultation research needs to be done into reform, and I'm sure we'll come on to reform later. I want just to ask a separate question about moving forward, because I think we all accept we are where we are at the moment, but it does concern me a comment made, I think it was Mr Moyer, who said that there are currently courts set up which are being mothballed. Now, we know we've got a backlog of nearly 50,000 cases to get through. That's of concern, I think, to everyone that we've spoken to on all sides of the coin, both at the Crown and, indeed, in the legal profession. But how do we address that backlog in the short term, in the immediate term, if there simply aren't enough people to do it? And that's maybe a question I'll direct at the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service, because you obviously have an ambitious drive to clear that backlog as soon as you can. And we can do it if we have the buildings, we can do it if we have the Crown resource, but we can't do it if there's no defence lawyers. So how do we plug that gap? I mean, that's quite a worrying move.
Do you want to come in, Mr. Fraser?
Thank you very much. Indeed, thank you very much. If I can put Mr. Moyer's comment in a little bit of context, within the recovery programme, which started on the 6th of September, we introduced an additional 10 summary courts across all of the estate. Now, my understanding in the Borders courts is we introduced two courts over a four-week period. I understand that one court has had to be put down as a result of the business being adjourned. So, I mean, overall, I would say that the recovery programme is working well across all of our courts, with the exception, obviously, of that experience that Mr. Moyer has. If I pull in a little bit in terms of the domestic abuse, I mean, Marcia Scott was absolutely right. 25% of cases that are lodged relate to domestic abuse, but in the course of this year, 44% of trials that have proceeded have been domestic abuse. So we have got a big focus in terms of that. I would say at this stage, and having listened to all the evidence, potentially one could form the view there is a problem brewing. But from the court's perspective, we are not seeing any sort of major disruption to the courts as a result of defence solicitors not being available. Now, that's partly due to the balance between the public defender and defence solicitors. But I'm not sure I could particularly answer your question in relation to difficulties in the courts. What I would say at this point is we are not seeing an impact. We are still managing to get business through. We have a recovery programme up and running, and for the vast majority, it is working well.
Thank you. That's not what the other panellists say. I mean, to be fair, they're telling us not just is there a crisis brewing, but it's already happening. Mr. Moore, can I ask you to pick up on your comments in response to Mr. Fraser?
Yes, thank you. What I would say is that for any of the courts to have a difficulty through a shortage of defence agents highlights that what we're saying is we're already at the point where the crisis is real. And the one point I really want to make is that when we say that you need to give an increase in legal aid fees so that we can retain and recruit lawyers, it's because otherwise it won't simply be in a month's time or 2 months' time, or there was one court that couldn't sit. We are heading to the point where we can't cover the cases that we have, and that's only going to get worse as week by week, two or three or four or five young lawyers or older lawyers, more experienced lawyers, are leaving to go and work for the other side of the table and for the Scottish Government. There aren't enough of us at the moment to cope with this long term. I've had probably 5 weeks holiday in 2.5 years because we're having to work flat out as it is. So there is no extra capacity to say we'll run an extra 10 courts and we'll have all the lawyers unless you do something about it to support us. And that's not some kind of gift. That is in reality looking at the fact that money is having to be spent across the board to get the backlog cleared. Quite rightly, money has been identified and spent on the remote jury centres. You know, we were part of all of these discussions. We've been constructive throughout. When we've been listened to and action has been taken, generally speaking, it's ended with a positive conclusion in things like the Resilience Fund, the Trainee Fund, and so on. What we're saying to you is you need to listen to us now before it's too late for us to fix any of these problems. We don't want a scenario where we're standing in front of a judge saying, you'll need to adjourn this trial because I have five other trials all in the same building and I have no other staff and I can't get any agents because they don't exist anymore because there's no funding in the system. We're trying to alert you now to the very real need for urgent action so that we can play our part in fixing the backlog. We're happy to engage. We always have been. And we always try and be constructive, but we need to be listened to.
Why did so many defence lawyers boycott the holiday courts? Is that constructive?
Well, I think it has to be seen against the background that without any consultation whatsoever, 8 further days of work were foisted upon us. As I say, we can't even take holidays. Now we don't get the holiday weekends either. So it was more felt as a great insult to the profession that we weren't consulted and we weren't asked about it. We were simply told, get on with it. There's no extra funding being discussed. The horse is bolted, so it's harder for you to get funding now. So it was the way in which it was done that caused such upset to the profession who have worked so hard to try and make this system work through lockdown. I was going into the Sheriff Court in full lockdown, putting myself at risk, putting my family at risk, to make sure that people that were kept in custody were represented, and we feel that was totally underappreciated.
Thank you. I'm sure the government are listening carefully to today's exchange. Thank you for your comments.
Thank you very much. I'm aware that there's quite a number of people wanting to come in. I'm conscious of time, so if I can ask for questions and responses to be as succinct as possible, I'll bring in Katie Clark, and then I think Mr. Lancaster, and then Dr. Scott. I'll bring you in. Katie Clark.
Thank you. My question's to Julia McPartlin and Ian Moyer to really find out exactly what it is you're suggesting in terms of the level of increase there needs to be in legal aid fees. You know, whether you're suggesting that, you know, the restructuring of legal aid to encourage pleas at an early stage would be sufficient to enable better recruitment for criminal defence agents, or whether you're suggesting a percentage increase across the board on criminal legal aid rates, and what kind of percentage you think is necessary now to enable you to recruit into the sector.
Thank you. That's a difficult question to answer. I don't think the reforms in terms of front-loading the system for early fees would address the problem in itself. And I think, in a way, an increase in reforms are separate. Reforms are about making what budget we have work in a smarter way. I suppose one way to look at it, I mean, we are realistic. We understand that there are constraints on the amount of money available. But if we were to take the fixed fee for summary work, which covers a lot of what we do, that was fixed in 1999. And there have been some decrease and then increases again in a small way. But if you were to adjust that fee for inflation, it would be worth in the region of £800 now. So I appreciate that that is a huge jump that may not be feasible with the constraints that you have, but that, I suppose, is a starting point to show what would bring us up to parity with what we were being paid back in 1999 and what was deemed to be a fair rate then. That perhaps would be a start. I don't want to put a percentage on it per se, but those are the sort of comparisons that might be used for government to work out what would be appropriate.
And can I ask Ian Moyer to come in on that? I mean, what actually would make a difference? What are you, you know, there could be an increase, but it might not be sufficient in terms of what you're arguing. So what do you actually think government needs to do?
Well, can I be clear that what I'm saying is that I'm more than happy for most of the things that are in the fee reform proposal to be taken forward. Indeed, many of them we've proposed. We've been arguing for a Section 76 fee for many years. But my difficulty is that any negotiation and successful conclusion to that, followed by legislation, is going to leave us too far down the road to solve the immediate crisis. And that's why I'm saying that we need to use the blunt tool of a significant increase, and Julia has given you the sort of indicators of what that might be in the very short term, because it's going to realistically take at least, I would think, 2 years to do the earlier parts of the reforms, and some of the reforms will take 3, 4, 5 years. I mean, the Evans Review was 4 or 5 years ago, and we're now at the stage of we need to instruct further investigation. So the reality is, it's going to take time, even with the best will in the world, and we need to plug the gap in the meantime. And that's why I'm saying in the short term, find money to give us a substantial rise to the existing fees so that we can recruit lawyers, retain lawyers, and actually represent people in court and keep the system moving and have people available to do custody courts at the weekends and cover COP26 and do police interviews at night time and so on. We're willing to do the job. You know, we need support, though.
So you're saying to maintain your business model and to recruit, you'd need to go back to 1999 levels in the immediate future?
I'm not saying a particular figure right now.
Structure, just in terms of what needs to be done now to make sure that we don't have a crisis
winter. In general terms, another 5% isn't going to fix it. It needs to be a substantial amount.
Okay, that's fine.
Thank you very much. I'll bring in Dr. Scott.
Would just like to pick up on a couple of things. One is that I have to say that I think the elephant in the room in some of this discussion is the failure to gender the whole problem. So, and I know that Ian Moore mentioned young women lawyers, and I think you know, the sort of intersection of COVID and its extraordinarily disproportionate impact on young women in terms of childcare and unpaid work reflects some of what's happening in the larger society and indeed in terms of solicitors. And I'm minded to say I was the chair of the Equality Advisory Group for the Crown Office prior to working at Scottish Women's Aid. And we did an analysis of the gender pay gap at that point for solicitors in Scotland. And it was the pay gap was much, much bigger in private sector provision. The work-life balance was much better in public sector provision. So I think there's a whole lot of issues here that go way beyond, you know, how much money is being offered to solicitors, and that require, as we go forward with reform and as we go forward with COVID recovery, if there's not more evidence of some equality impact assessments in all of these procedures and analysis, then we will continue to be having these conversations in 5 or 10 years. I want also just to very quickly point out that the Scottish government's work on addressing women's homelessness because of domestic abuse, recommendations from the Improving Housing Outcomes for Women and Children report were all accepted by the Scottish government, one of which included that legal advice should for women and children experiencing domestic abuse should be available, easily accessible, free domestic abuse competent legal advice and representation. So I really hope that the committee will think about how that gets embedded in any legal reform and changes to legal aid as we go forward, because that is a commitment the government has already made. And finally, about the backlog, I have to say that the setting up of cases is back to pre-COVID levels, and that the Crown Office has done a really good job of privileging domestic abuse cases and all of that. But the reality is, as far as we know, there are still only one out of about 5 cases going forward because of all the problems in the system, many of which related to COVID. And I think some hard decisions are really going to have to be made by the government and by the criminal justice system about just what cases need to be taken out of the backlog so that the domestic abuse cases and the other really high priority cases have the space to go forward and the resources to do so.
Thank you, Dr. Scott. I'll very quickly bring in Mr. Lancaster, and then I'd like to move the discussion on to some other aspects and bring in Mr. Finlay. So, Mr. Lancaster.
Okay, thank you. I'll try and be quick here. I think in general, the question about what would make a difference is very difficult to answer in the short term, because I think I agree with other panel members that what we've got is a long-term situation here. As we said in our submission, what we've seen is over 10 years, a 35% reduction in the number of criminal prosecutions. What we've seen is a 20% reduction in the number of criminal practitioners over that time. So there's been a little bit of a mismatch in the trends there. What we're seeing right now is a very sudden increase in demand. And given the shape of the sector that we have, where we've got predominantly small firms, 40% of the firms providing criminal legal assistance have only 2 or fewer criminal lawyers in them. It's very difficult for those firms to flex their capacity. So I absolutely understand that during COVID it was an extremely difficult time, and firms had to work in all sorts of different ways. It's been really challenging for them. And I can see that the backlog reduction measures then present as a significant challenge as well, because that ability to flex capacity to meet demand is really constrained in those small firms. And similarly, some of the issues Marcia was talking about there in terms of gender, work-life balance, some of those may be associated with the structure of the system we have and the structure of the market and the small firms who might struggle to do that. So I think that's very difficult to see how immediately a fee increase would address those points. The payment panel obviously looked at all of that and concluded that there was really a lack of evidence about all of those issues, and we need to know more to better understand the problem, the scale of the problem, the causes of the problem, and then we can design solutions to actually address the problems once we understand them. At the moment, there really is a lack of that good information out there.
Thank you very much. Mr. Finlay, would you like to?
Yes, hello, Mr. Lancaster. I'd like to talk to you about the issue of fraud and abuse of legal aid. Now, by my reckoning, since the banking crash, the amount legal aid has paid out in Scotland amounts to just under £1.9 billion, which is rich pickings, and it appears to be rather tempting for some. In my previous job as a journalist, I reported extensively on a number of solicitors who committed suspected fraud in relation to legal aid. I won't name names, but all this is in the public domain, but I think it's worthwhile just touching on some of the detail. One particular solicitor claimed £600,000 in 2 years. These were unnecessary and excessive claims and done in order to exploit the legal aid fund. It took 4 years to ban him from claiming legal aid. Another one submitted 81 described as fictional accounts. This was described as being fraudulent. However, he was not prosecuted. A third solicitor claimed £560,000 in 1 year. He had a history of such abuse. yet it took several more years to strike him off. Now, around about the same time as that, we became aware of 14 solicitors being reported to the Crown Office for similar fraud. That 14 may or may not have comprised these three who I mentioned, and none were the subject of any criminal proceedings. I would just like to ask you, as the kind of gatekeeper and the guardian of these huge sums of public money, whether similar types of abuse are still happening today?
Okay, thanks, Mr. Findlay. I think I know some of the cases that you're referring to there, and there is, you introduced your question by referring to fraud and abuse. Those are subtly, but importantly, different things. I think the first case that you referred to there really was around the abuse of legal aid doing unnecessary work simply to generate fee income. And as you say, it took some time for action to be taken there. I think we have we may have previously corresponded about the matter, but certainly we've responded to FOI requests on this point and confirmed that we didn't need to recover any funds in those cases because we only paid for that work, which we considered to be necessary and appropriate. I should say that there's quite a complicated landscape here in terms of regulation, and that landscape has changed a bit over the years. There are different powers that we have in relation to civil, children's and criminal legal aid. We have fewer powers in relation to civil legal aid than we do in relation to criminal. The overarching power to exclude people from delivering legal aid was originally held by the Law Society of Scotland. That was changed several years ago and that power transferred to SLAB, but it remains a slightly complex picture of exactly what powers can apply to what types of legal aid. Generally speaking, we have got a programme of compliance audit, of peer review of solicitors. We check accounts rigorously. I think sometimes the profession would argue that we check their accounts too rigorously. We certainly want to be sure that we are taking a proportionate balance here, and that enables us to identify any patterns in charging which appear to be suspicious. If there's anything inflated, we can investigate those and we can take action where necessary. I can't comment on decisions about prosecutions for fraud. That's entirely a matter for the police and then the Crown Office, whether or not those are prosecuted. But we're not aware at present of there being a significant problem in terms of the assurance work that we do.
Thank you for that. That's helpful. I understand the difference between fraud and sort of questionable claims, but some of the language used in respect to these specific cases was quite clear that it was fraudulent. Why did these cases all appear to happen in the past 10-year period or so? Was there a problem then that we now have fixed, or was it just the fact that the media did a job and identified it? And what confidence can the public have that these abuses aren't happening, especially against the backdrop of what the profession is describing as a crisis in legal aid?
Again, I can't be sure exactly which cases you're talking about or exactly which circumstances are present in those cases, but certainly where we see where we observe as a result of either our analysis, our investigations, our accounts assessment, where we observe sort of new behaviours, we can make sure that we are then monitoring those and then, if you like, at that gateway in terms of when people are asking us to pay their bills, making sure that we are implying controls. So, if you like, we learn from the cases that we observe and we change our controls in response to that. So if we spotted a thing, and that may be a thing that we have then reported onward to the Crown or the police, we'll make sure that the processes that we adopt day to day in assessing accounts, for example, will look out for those things and make sure that we are preventing any further issues arising. So it may be that there is a particular issue at a point in time, but that the steps that we have then taken in terms of our accounts assessment processes and the checks that we undertake will have been effective in managing that for the future.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. I'd like the session to run on a little bit to 11:40, so we've got about 7 minutes or so left. I'd like us to move on and look at aspects of reform and different models for change, just to sort of bring things to a close. And I'd like to start off maybe with Ms. Mackay, followed by Jamie Green.
Thank you, Convener. Yep. My question would be to Gillian Fife, please. Your submission states that the demand for advice on legal aid has risen by 32% during the pandemic. But you point out that legal aid isn't currently available for many simple procedure cases, civil being the legal area that citizens' advice deals with in the majority of cases. I just wondered if you could see what impact this has on you helping people to gain access to justice, going back to that, and what you know, what changes, if any, you wanted to propose in that regard.
Thank you. I suppose our submission, you know, touches on the fact that we consider that the user must be put at the heart of the legal aid system, and by the user I mean the recipient of the service. Also appreciate that the profession is also a user of the system as well. In terms of the point about civil legal aid not being available for certain actions, quite a lot of the issues we see in terms of legal proceedings, simple procedure is a significant proportion of the issues that come to Citizens Advice Bureau. And we've heard during the pandemic. Difficulty understanding the process for that, even though it's meant to be simple procedure and it's for small claims. There are a number of in-court advice projects that run in different parts of the country that are funded by SLAB that can offer lay representation and in-court advice on issues such as simple procedure, and some of them are hosted in Citizens Advice Bureau. This coverage is not national, so if you happen to have an issue in a bit of the country where there is a project, you can get that support, but it's not national coverage. And this is one of the reasons we think there should be sort of a recasting of the budget, the legal aid budget, so that there's more of a focus on grant funding, early intervention and prevention, so that people can get the advice and support early on. They can get advice on alternative dispute resolution as well, and that will help with the early resolution as well if they feel that's appropriate for them. But I suppose in simple procedure in particular, during the pandemic, we've heard from advisors that clients have found it difficult to navigate the process without having the supporter in court with them. And there's some concern about clients not understanding the gravity of the situation and not having the individual there present to help them. It's been more difficult in instances over the phone or over video conference. So that's the kind of situation we've seen in the network over the pandemic period.
Thank you. Could you maybe just repeat the part about it not being national? So is that some kind of postcode lottery then in that sense? Has that always been the case?
And my understanding is that it was never meant to be sort of national provision. It's sort of a function, it's administered by SLAB, but Scottish Government sort of set the priority for it. So there are different projects in different parts of the country. Other organisations can also bid for this funding and do bid for this funding. So it is a bit of a patchwork in provision, and we would like to see that made on a more national footing, so that everybody can get that type of help rather than just possibly being able to get it if you happen to be located in an area that has a project that does that.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. I'll move on. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Green, would you like to come in?
Thank you. So the issue of reform is not a new subject or topic to the committee, I suspect, or to our guests this morning. We had four written submissions, and the issue of reform was touched on in each of them. I think it's fair to say that the Bar Association focused more on the fees and the financial aspect of reform. The Scottish Legal Aid Board, I think, accepted themselves that there is the need for both short-term and medium to long-term reform. And I was quite taken by the submission from Citizens Advice, who gave some more pragmatic suggestions around things like triage and early intervention. I guess I want to open it up to the panel. Other than the issue of fees, legal aid fees, and funding of the sector, which we've discussed at great length already, what other practical or even immediate reforms could we make or should we be making to improve legal aid? And that's an open question
Anyone in particular you would like to...
I don't want to direct to anyone specifically, because I'm sure all the panellists have a view on it, and if you don't, now is your opportunity to share your views.
Yep. Sorry, I beg your pardon. Mr. Lancaster, do you like to come in?
Yes, thank you. Obviously, we did touch on some of the possibilities for reform in our submission, and I would say that there are a combination of short-term and long-term structural reforms that would be possible. In the short term, as I've already mentioned, aspects of both the feeing system and, say, the eligibility system, some of the tests for legal aid, can be quite complex. Some of that can only be fixed by primary legislation, some of it could be fixed by regulations, and some of it might be a thing that we can look at as part of how we apply the tests, how we run our processes. So we have some discretion afforded by the regulations, and where we do, we are currently in the midst of a project where we're looking at how we express our policies in relation to the application of discretion, how we turn that into clear guidance for the profession, and how that can help us train our own staff to make sure that we have a transparent, a consistent service with consistent, predictable decision making, where we can be held accountable if the decisions we take don't actually match up to the policy as we've published it. On Friday, we launched a consultation in relation to how we assess accounts. That's always a hot topic with the profession, and we'd be delighted to hear their views on how we go about that process, how we apply the tests that are set out in the regulations, the information we need to help us come to decisions first time, so that we can pay more of the accounts that we receive at the first time of asking, and therefore that smooths the process. We will also in due course be running a consultation on how we apply the means test. That's come up a couple of times today. It is complicated. There are various pockets of discretion and uncertainty in there. So again, trying to clarify that, trying to make it transparent and consistent in a way that applicants can then better understand what it is we need from them to enable us to make decisions on their cases. So those sorts of things, I think, are the short term things that might make a difference to the smooth running of the system, pending those longer term legislative fixes that are really for ministers to determine and in due course for Parliament.
Could I make a request, therefore, whilst your written submission was helpful, a one-page summary of ideas for reform, it sounds like you had very specific asks, some of which are legislative, some of which are policy-driven, some of which are for the government, but we as a committee perhaps have a role to play in some of that. Could you perhaps put in writing those very specific ideas or recommendations that you would like to see introduced, and then we perhaps could debate them as a committee?
No, absolutely. A number of them were contained in our response to the government's consultation. And as I say, those other more immediate things are things that we're looking at the moment. So certainly I'm happy to keep the committee appraised of our thinking as that develops. And the live consultation, we can certainly pass on to the clerk so that you can see what it is we're talking about there.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'll just finish off the session. I'm afraid time is against us. I know, Mr. Moyer, you would like to come in, and then we'll close this particular part of the meeting. Mr. Moyer.
Thank you. I won't take long because I'm conscious of the time. One positive example of working closely with the Legal Aid Board, we were recently able to remove the interest of justice test from the application form for sheriff summary cases, because it was felt that if it had been prosecuted at that level, it automatically met the test. So that speeded up the process and is a good thing for the profession and the Legal Aid Board. One thing I want to highlight that has been on the agenda for some time and seems to have dropped off it is a single grant of legal aid. And what I mean by that is that somebody has legal aid from the start of a process to the end, other than in the police station, which is separate work. Because at the moment we find situations where somebody might have to apply for several different types of legal aid throughout the history of the case. If, for example, they're given a community payback order and the court fixes a review, and you can find a situation in an extreme example in the High Court where somebody gets an exceptional disposal of a community payback order and there was no cover for them to be represented at the review. So that's one thing that I would like to see us working on in the short term is a single grant, so that the lawyer knows that they will be paid for all the work they do, and the applicant knows that they have cover for the duration of the case.
Thank you very much. I'd like to just bring this session to a close. Again, I apologise for the lack of time. So really, there's so much to cover. Many thanks to all the witnesses who have joined us today. And of course, if there are outstanding points that you would like to share with the committee, please feel free to follow them up in writing, and we will of course take them into account as additional evidence. So again, my thanks to all our witnesses for attending today, and we'll now take a 5-minute break before we move on to our next agenda item. Thank you. Thank you, members. And our next agenda item this morning will be for us to take evidence on the Prisons and Young Offenders Institutions Coronavirus Scotland Amendment Number 2 Rules of 2021 from Mr Keith Brown, Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans, Mr Tom Fox, Head of Corporate Affairs of the Scottish Prison Service, and Mr Jamie McQueen, Scottish Government Legal Directorate. And I welcome you all to the meeting. For your information, Mr Fulton McGregor is joining us online today due to some travel disruption. And I refer members to paper number 4. So as you know, last week we considered the SSI and agreed to contact the Scottish Government and the Scottish Prison Service with some questions. And I thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for the written response that you provided and that we received earlier this week. So we thought it would be useful to invite you today to appear at the meeting to discuss this SSI further and answer any questions. So thank you for attending. It's very much appreciated. So Cabinet Secretary, can I ask if you would like to make any brief opening remarks before we open up to questions from committee members?
If I could do, convener, be brief, if I could do that. Thank you, and thanks for the invitation to come along. The Prison and Young Offenders Institutions Coronavirus Scotland Amendment No. 2 Rules extend the application of certain modifications made to the prison rules in response to the coronavirus pandemic by the Amendment Rules 2020, SSI 2020-122. The current amendments to the rules are due to expire tomorrow, and the purpose of this instrument is to extend the application of the changes until 31st of March next year and revoke others which are no longer considered to be required. Given the unique operating environment of the prison setting, the Prison Service considers it necessary to retain some of the flexibility afforded by previous rule amendments made during the pandemic to ensure the safe running of our prisons for the duration of the pandemic. And the Prison Service consider it necessary to take steps to retain some of the flexibility afforded by previous SSIs made during the pandemic to ensure that we are prepared and able to focus on any immediate priorities that arise. That members, of course, are aware that the threat of coronavirus and the operation of the justice system remains. As at Monday this week, there were 136 positive COVID cases spread across 9 prisons in the prison estate, so vigilance is vital, and the Scottish Prison Service has a very good track record in this area compared to other jurisdictions. So this SSI seeks to retain some of the powers taken in response to the pandemic for prison governors, and they give prison governors the flexibility of precautionary and responsive measures to prevent and limit the spread of the virus, and crucially to ensure the safety and well-being of those who live, work and visit our prisons. Some of the key powers being retained are the powers that allow governors to suspend or restrict, if necessary, in-person visits, purposeful activity and recreation in response to local outbreaks. Rule 40A and the extended timescales on Rule 41, which provide governors and local NHS partners with the means to comply with Public Health Scotland and Scottish Government advice in relation to isolation of large groups or individuals who are symptomatic or who have been in close contact with a person who is symptomatic, or identified as a close contact of a person who is symptomatic, or are new admissions that may prevent a COVID-19 risk. The ability as well for governors to extend the period a prisoner is on home leave for up to 14 days from the normal 7 days, where prisoners advise that they or someone in their home has coronavirus or has developed symptoms of coronavirus. The committee are aware in advance of laying this SSI, a tailored consultation was undertaken by SBS in July with stakeholders such as Howard League, Families Outside and HM Inspector of Prisons for Scotland. In addition, an operational review also determined that not all amendments to the prison rules would require to be maintained due to the return across the majority of the estate to a regular two-shift model working day in October, with staff attendance patterns that better support a fuller regime model. The majority of amendments revoked by this instrument are in the main related to admin processes and associated timescales in areas such as the internal disciplinary processes and requests and complaints. But the rules being retained are intended to remain in force until 31st March next year, but they can be revoked earlier if necessary. And consistent with the wider community, the Prison Service is opening up regimes across the estate, and it remains their priority to continue to transition to a full regime in alignment with public health advice. And so for clarity, these powers are therefore proposed as precautionary measures and will only be used if necessary and proportionate. They will be subject to multidisciplinary input decision-making and will be kept under review if in place. SBS senior HQ staff and governors will continue to work with the government and NHS colleagues to ensure that the most up-to-date information available is used to inform the response and contingency planning. And given the uncertainty as we approach another winter, it's essential that the government ensures that the prison service can rapidly respond to all eventualities of this pandemic, whether nationally or locally. And to conclude, this draft instrument provides for precautionary powers essential to the prison service's continuing response to the pressures facing prisons during the pandemic. And I welcome any questions that the committee may have. Convener, thank you.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I'll just now open it up to members for any questions that you may have. Ms. Stevenson.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and thanks very much for your written submission. It's really more to do with the inspectorate and the role that they're going to play in terms of this precautionary measure. My concern is the human rights of the prisoners within these estates in terms of particularly purposeful activity and recreation as well. And it's just to get some reassurance from you in terms of what role the inspectorate will play going forward and obviously the mental health of some of these prisoners in light of these precautionary measures.
Thanks for the question. Of course, the Inspector of Constabulary has the powers which are set out in statute to inspect prisons and various other elements of scrutiny of prisons, which perhaps Mr. Fox would want to speak to. But I would say the prison service itself, of course, has carried out a human rights assessment prior to doing this. And I think I understand the concerns that committee members will have, but I think the one thing to say is that the way it's worked over the pandemic, first of all, I'm not suggesting that this has been proposed or suggested, but the governors are not tyrants, and they know that the best way of managing a prison is to allow the maximum possibility for purposeful activity, for visits and so on. And that's why they've worked very hard for alternatives to those. So that tends to help with the easier running of the prison. So the point I'm making is sometimes restricting those things is actually not in the governor's interest, and they would only do it because the health needs were there for it. So the safeguards are the conversations that they, of course, have with SPS headquarters. There is the possibility for legal action to be taken if a governor's extending their powers. And there is, of course, the constabulary. Plus, of course, there is the ECHR regulations which are there. But maybe I don't know if officials want to speak to any further powers which the constabulary, the inspector of prisons has in relation to that.
Happy to. I think you're quite right to be concerned about the human rights of prisoners. I think all of us should be concerned about that. And the inspectorate have been very diligent throughout the pandemic in maintaining as good an inspection regime as they could possibly do. One of the things which has been remarkable during this pandemic is the level of cooperation that prisoners have shown to staff in what are very challenging and difficult circumstances for them. And I think they've done that because they've seen the legitimacy of what we are trying to do, which is preserve the health and well-being not only of the people living and working in prisons, but the people who are coming to visit. And the measures that we've taken to put in place things like virtual visits have helped in that, and the ability of people to contact families by phone have been significant help. Of significant help in maintaining that legitimacy. But please be assured, the inspectorate is on our case quite regularly, as they are entitled to be, and they take their job very seriously, and we take the comments that they make to us very seriously and respond to them as quickly and as timeously as we can. The inspectorate has been very diligent in visiting prisons. And even when visits were not possible, they were on the case, I assure you, and as we would expect them to be.
Okay, thank you very much. I'll bring in Mr. Green, followed by Mr. McGregor.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, just about good afternoon. Thanks for coming along today. You will note that the committee briefly debated this previous session. I guess my comments and indeed questions are centred around two distinct areas. One is around the process of our deliberations of the instrument, and the other is around the substance. And I guess on the latter, I do have sympathy on the need for the extension of some of these powers for the very reasons you've outlined today. But perhaps on the former, I've got less sympathy with the government on the way in which we're having to process the instrument. So I'll maybe start with that first. These current powers expire tomorrow, which I would say leaves the committee in quite an invidious position of either having to agree or disagree with their extension. Why is it the case, Cabinet Secretary, that these only came to us last week, given that there was the likelihood that there may be some controversy or indeed questions or concerns that have been raised by numerous members across the political spectrum around the content and the nature of the extension of some of these powers and the effect it will have on the prison population?
I think it's true, and even from my recent experience on committees, that there have been a number of times during the pandemic when perhaps the usual expected patterns of development of these measures has been curtailed, I think, for fairly obvious reasons. And I think it's also true to say that it probably wasn't possible to predict, even in where we're near the end of September and July, exactly what stage of the pandemic we'd be at, although it was predictable, of course, when these powers were due to expire. But I can see that one of the officials wants to come in on this. Do you want to say anything more?
Yes, so this is an instrument subject to the negative procedure, and it's actually been laid in accordance with the Parliament's standing orders. And I appreciate, ideally, you would have it comes into force before the kind of expiry of that 40-day period for a negative instrument. But one of the issues we had was that we wanted to carry out this consultation, which was in response to the previous Justice Committee's comments on the last instrument, which extended this. So there was time had to be built in for that particular consultation. And again, for that consultation to be effective, we had to have a sort of position about where we wanted to be ourselves, which took obviously a bit of time, but it was difficult to do that further in advance, really. So the instrument has actually been laid in accordance with the various periods that are set out in the standing orders. I think it was laid on the 26th of August and has been in the Parliament since it was laid on the 30th of August, sorry, and so has been through the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, and I think was in this committee last week. So there's still time for this session today to allow kind of further evidence to be taken, which the committee has obviously taken the opportunity to do.
Yeah, thank you. And that's a technical answer to my question. But nonetheless, the powers do expire tomorrow. So there's very little room for movement there for the committee whatsoever to either take further evidence, to scrutinise or to interrogate any of the stakeholders who inputted into the consultation. In fact, we've learned in the response they received late last night that the consultation responses will be published in October, which is way after the instrument is presumably passed and the powers are extended for another 6 months. I mean, that doesn't strike me as acceptable.
Well, can I maybe just say, first of all, it may be a technical answer, it's also a factually correct one, that we've observed the standing orders of the Parliament, and there is a role for the committees if they want to get earlier consideration. This is now the second committee of the Parliament to consider these powers, and I think that is, especially in the context of a pandemic, and especially having undertaken a voluntary consultation exercise, it wasn't required to do that. So I think the prison service have done the right thing in relation to that. And of course, if the committee wanted to negate the instrument, they can do that, or it can be done through the Parliament, and the powers would continue until that process happens. So I don't think there's a material loss of benefit, if you like, to the scrutiny process in that regard. And on the consultation responses, I mean, I did try to explain that in my response to the committee, that they did not get the permission from the consultees to publicise those responses, and they're working to ensure they can do that, although some of them are known to members of the committee. And as soon as those permissions have been granted, then they will publish. And you're right to say it's next month, but next month is on Friday. I'm not saying it'll be published on Friday, but the next month starts on Friday, so it'll be published as soon as it's possible to do that.
OK, thank you for that. And that addresses my process queries and concerns, and I think they're noted on the record, and others may have comment on that. But on the substance of the powers that are being extended, in the letter, which actually I think helpfully summarised some of the consultation responses which we've been unable to see ourselves, I think it's fair to say my impression of the three-page letter is that there was more concern than praise raised, put it that way, given the nature of it. And if we look at them in turn, there was concerns raised on rules 40A on time limits, on 41A on accommodation, 63A, suspension of visits, 84A, purposeful activity, 88A, recreation. I mean, that's effectively the entirety of the powers that the government are seeking to extend. And of the substantive responses, the three organisations, all of them expressed concerns about some of them, including some of them even suggesting potential amendments. Now, we can't amend this instrument. We don't even vote on it, indeed, which is unfortunate. But given the context of some of these concerns that we have, and I'm sure we can go into them in detail, why does the government think it appropriate simply to nod through the extension of these powers in their entirety as they currently exist, given the levels of concerns and the nature of the concerns that have been raised by stakeholders through the consultation process?
Well, we could say that we are not nodding these through, and I think with the process that's been undertaken with the consultation, which again I emphasise the SPS did not have to undertake, but they were right to do so, and it was a limited consultation, I would acknowledge that point. I'm not sure it is true that the balance was critical. I know the officials may have the exact details, but there were some who didn't respond at all, some who responded to say they had no comment. And you're right to say that the issues which were raised were significant and probably reflect the issues which are due to be raised by committee members today. They are the obvious issues where there are concerns. So the government did not at that stage nod this through. We talked to the prison service about this, and we believe on balance, for the reasons which have been given and which I referred to in my statement, it is the right thing to do to allow these powers. And I would just say, from my point of view, that I understand, of course, these extend through to the 31st of March next year. But I have made the point previously that the nature of the pandemic is changing, and it changes all the time. Hopefully today we'll see further progress when we see the figures. And for my part, I would undertake, if the committee wishes me to come back before that time, if the nature of the pandemic has changed, and to discuss further the need for these powers. I'm more than willing to do that. But I think at this point, the government has considered the consultation responses and believe that on balance, this is the right way to go.
And that's a very welcome offer and undertaking. I think we all accepted from the beginning when we granted the government emergency COVID powers that they would not be enforced for a moment longer, and I think those are words even the government themselves have used, and that commitment is welcome. There are obviously reservations, though, that may not happen, despite the lowering prevalence of the virus. Can I ask about the cases that currently exist in the prison state? Have we done any analysis on where those are? Is it staff? Is it inmates? How do we think the cases are coming into the prison estate? Are those numbers on the rise? Have they levelled out? Or are they on the drop? Just to give it some context.
If I can just come in, yeah. I'm just really conscious of the time, and I'd quite like the discussion to remain focused on the SSI, if you don't mind. If there's anything further you'd like to ask, fine. Otherwise, I'll move on to Mr. McGregor.
Sure.
Yeah, thank you. Mr. McGregor, followed by Ms. McNeill.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon, actually, Cabinet Secretary and officials. I think probably most people on the committee are minded to agree to this today, but I've also got some concerns. I think have already been articulated by Colette Stevenson and Jamie Green, and it does relate to the vulnerability, if you like, of a lot of our prisoners. And you know, I think we should all feel slightly uncomfortable when we're extending this legislation, but at the same time recognising that we are in a pandemic, and you know, we need to do what's necessary to keep people safe. But in that context, and it probably is coming on to maybe where Jamie Green was going there slightly. Can I ask about the vaccination status of prisoners and how that has impacted the government's decision to go for an extension here? Because it seems to me that in most of society, and there's going to be another debate this afternoon on exactly this issue, that vaccines are a very important part of allowing us to reopen and live with less restrictions. Is there an issue with either staff or inmates being vaccinated in prisons? Is that an issue? Because it does seem that, like, you know, I know the Howard League have raised concerns about visits and stuff like that. These are real human rights concerns. has vaccine status been taken into account in this particular decision? Thanks.
I wonder if it would be helpful, and not least as well, given Jamie Green's previous question, if we can look at what information we can provide. I would say initially that I get an update every week, sometimes more than that, on both the vaccination rates for prisoners and for staff, and also the presence of the virus that's there as well. And that has implications, as Fulton McGregor rightly says, for visiting. Also, when people come directly into custody as part of the judicial process, there are processes in place there to try and minimise transmission. So I would say in general terms, and I'll get the specific figures and as far as I'm able to you on that, but in general terms, it's the same profile as the general population. So the same process has been followed in terms of the age population, people when they get the vaccination. I think from memory there's a higher incidence of refusals amongst prisoner in the prisoner population, but again, I'll get that detail to you. But just to say that if it provides any further reassurance, if you look at the way it's done, it's done by governors in consultation, has to be done in consultation with health professionals. So health professionals wouldn't likely insist on measures which are going to be, you know, say a prison governor for whatever reason wanted to have a more stringent regime. They couldn't just do it because they wanted to do it. They can only do it under these regulations because a health professional says this is required. And bear in mind, we're dealing with a closed population, and So we have had a number of outbreaks. It's currently, as I've said, in 9 different prisons just now. And what happens is as it bubbles up in a particular prison, then the incident management team go in there and they take relevant measures. So it's a very real threat that's there, and the ability for it to spread very quickly is also more prevalent than in the general population. So I think it is being done for the right reasons and only for those reasons, and it's not in the prison governor's interest to use these powers for anything other than health reasons. But I'll try and get as much information as is possible to pass on to the committee. I'll write to yourself for that information, convener, for the benefit of members.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Mr. McGregor, any further questions? No, thank you. Ms. McNeill, followed by Ms. Mackay.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. So I reiterate what Colette Stevenson said earlier. In fact, Owen Fox also acknowledged that all of us are concerned about the conditions of prisoners and the rights of prisoners. So we're all coming from the same place, I think. First of all, can I acknowledge your detailed answer to the committee, which I thought was very helpful, and to see some of the response to the consultation was also very helpful. But I'm sure it's acknowledged by you, Cabinet Secretary, at the end of the day, whatever the rights and wrongs of the process is, this committee has a decision to make, and we're decision makers when it comes to SSIs. I'm sure that is acknowledged by everyone. So it may well be that I agree with Fulton McGregor that we may be minded to pass this, or I may be minded to lend my support to this. But with all the reservations I think other members have already given about not having the appropriate time to consider it and all of the concerns. So that is my kind of line of thought, if you like. So I'm right in saying that the powers that you would be seeking to extend would relate to purposeful activity, suspension of visits and detention of prisoners in cells, with all the rules around health professionals and human rights, but those are the kind of range of powers that you're seeking to extend. Yeah.
Yes, and I think the ones which we're not seeking to extend, which we're seeking to revoke, are largely to do with internal administrative and disciplinary processes, but you're right to identify the ones that we wish to extend. Yeah.
So I did note that one of the ones that you are revoking, I just wanted to confirm that I've understood it, is the provision of newspapers and materials that's to be revoked, so that will now be allowed.
Yeah, thank you.
I was just, when I first read it, I thought I wouldn't like to think there was any real reason for newspapers and reading materials, particularly for those prisoners who are detained. In relation to the time limits, there's no time limits, and obviously I understand there's caveats. Are you certain that this aspect of it complies with human rights law?
I think Mr. Fox is looking to come in this point as well. Yes, we've looked at both, obviously, the government's lawyers, but also the SPS as well. They're very conscious, and it really is the case to take a human rights based approach to this. And it's also not a hollow threat that they can be challenged on this by individual prisoners or their representatives if they were to be in breach of human rights legislation. So yes, that's been looked at, but I don't know if Mr. Fox would want to
just on the general point. I think it's worth saying that at the moment we are trying to begin the process of normalisation as best we can. Staff changed their attendance patterns at work to enable the maximum number of individuals to get access to exercise and the like during the pandemic. We're going back to a more normal regime. So many of the things that we have restricted should start to normalise over the next few months. But it's essential to retain the capacity to take measures if we need to take them. So as recently as a couple of weeks ago, we had an outbreak in Perth that necessitated significant numbers of people being placed on lockdown as a precautionary measure. Now, it's not something we would seek to do normally, but we need to retain the ability to do it as and when the circumstance necessitate it. But over the next few months, we should see prisons returning to much more normal regimes than has been the case over the last 18 months. Visits have resumed everywhere. The uptake in visits, unfortunately, hasn't been as great as we would have hoped, but that normalisation is going ahead. We simply need to have the ability to manage exceptional circumstances as and when they arise during the rest of this pandemic.
Thank you. That's really helpful. And I'm sure it's appreciated by Cabinet Secretary. We do appreciate, well, I would certainly acknowledge that these powers will be needed. What we're interested in is where are the safeguards? If we pass this today, I would need to be satisfied that those safeguards exist. And I just finish on what you've already said to Jamie Green, which, as you said, I am uncomfortable that they are extended to March. Might be a reason for me to vote against them, just with the length of time you're asking for. And I've accepted a lot of what you've said, and I would acknowledge that. You did say to Jamie Green that you would be prepared to bring it back before then. And I would have to say, Matt, for me to support this, I would need that absolutely confirmed, because I think that to ask for these, I could not vote for 6 months to extend what are quite wide-ranging powers with all the safeguards and caveats without it being brought to the committee before March next year.
Well, just to say on that, can we just be clear on what I'm saying is we are asking for the powers to be extended to the 31st of March next year. I think the point I was trying to make is that the nature of the pandemic can change quite quickly. So just say, for example, hypothetical, I have no inside knowledge on this, but say we saw a very benevolent decrease in the pandemic, such that the incidence both in the prison estate and elsewhere was much smaller. I think that would inevitably raise concerns for the committee. And in that context, or in another context, if it goes a different way, I'm more than willing to come back to the committee and explain and listen to any concerns at that stage. That's the offer that we'd make at this stage.
Thank you.
Okay, Ms Mackay.
Very, very brief, thank you, Convener. It's just about virtual visits. We know that they've been really successful, and the Cabinet Secretary acknowledges that in his letter. It's just to confirm that they will be retained if necessary. Would they be escalated? And do you know if that's a general approach that will be taken by governors throughout the estate?
I think virtual visits are here to stay. They're a very important addition to what's available in prisons, not least of what, I mean, there's been windfall benefits. Foreign national prisoners are getting visits. They never got visits before because they don't have family here, obviously. It's a boon for people living in more isolated communities in Scotland who are able to visit their family members without 2 or 3 days' travel. It also enhances the ability of prisoners to contact the young families and children. So yes, I think we would be committed to continue to provide virtual visits, not as a replacement for physical visits, but as an adjunct to it.
Thank you. Yeah, that's fine. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Any other questions? No. Thank you very much. That's fine. Thank you very much. Can I thank you, Cabinet Secretary and our officials, for your attendance today. And I'm now going to suspend the meeting for a short time before we move on to the next agenda item. Thank you very much. Okay, thank you very much, members. We'll now move on to agenda item 4, and this is for the committee to consider the Prisons and Young Offenders Institution Coronavirus Scotland Amendment Number 2 Rules of 2021. Can I ask if any members have any comments on the SSI? Mr. Green.
Thank you, Convener, for your forbearance, and to thank the Cabinet Secretary and his officials on the record for attending today, perhaps unusually for a negative instrument, but given the nature of it, it was helpful. I do not propose to raise a motion to annul the negative instrument. However, I would simply like to note the instrument, and therefore it will come into force tomorrow, subject to the agreement of the rest of the committee, but do so under the caveats that there have been concerns raised, not just by committee members, but clearly throughout the consultation process as well. And my caveats are twofold. One is that if, when the consultation responses are released to the committee and to the wider public in October, it becomes clear that there are wider substantive problems with those powers that we are extending today for tomorrow, that we'd reserve the right to request the Cabinet Secretary to reappear to the committee to respond, and indeed the Scottish Prison Service and perhaps Her Majesty's Inspectorate also. And equally, given the length of the duration of the extension, perhaps it would be prudent in a midway point, perhaps January of next year, to, as a committee, at least review where we are with the extension of those powers and if we're still comfortable or if there are still concerns within the committee. Now, I appreciate that doesn't change the outcome of the proceedings today, but I think it's important to put that on the record that the committee and indeed wider stakeholders had concerns with the extension of these powers. But given the cliff edge nature of the extension today, and as I said, the invidious position we are in to approve or not today, we are where we are.
Thank you very much, and that's helpful, and will be noted in the minute. Katie Clark.
Thank you. I also do not intend to move a motion to annul, but I do have significant concerns about the statutory instrument, and in particular the length of time that it would be in place, and therefore I would want the Scottish Government to come back if circumstances were to change. The concerns, I think, also are in relation to the practical implementation of the statutory instrument and how the substantial powers that governors will have are implemented, and that is something that I think the committee would want to be kept advised on, to be satisfied that the human rights of individuals in prison were respected, but also that the approach was consistent with health guidance that is in place outside of prisons. So I think we would have preferred as a committee if the statutory instrument had been for a shorter period, and it's unfortunate that the Scottish Government doesn't feel able to do that on this particular occasion. And for that reason, the committee, I believe, should be kept closely advised of how this particular piece of legislation is implemented.
Thank you very much. Ms McNeill?
Thank you, Convener. I agree with what has been said so far. I'll try not to repeat those points. Mm-hmm. I would have been minded to support a motion to annul. However, I'm content with what's been said. And just to note for the record that this SSI includes the potential suspension of part of assault activity, suspension of visitation rights, and to detain prisoners in a cell where a health professional has obviously said that there's cause for concern around coronavirus. So I acknowledge that there are reasons to have those powers. I do agree with Jamie Green and Katie Clark, mm-hmm. and that is that it's the length of time and the consistency of governance decisions I think the committee need to keep a watchful eye on. And I think since the Cabinet Secretary has indicated to the committee that he would be happy to come back and return to this, then I'm content not to do anything other than to note the instrument and not move against it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Finlay.
Yeah, thank you. I agree broadly with what everything has been said so far. As Jamie Green noted, we are where we are. One thing I would perhaps suggest or least put on the record is that we were only given a pretty partial picture a week ago, and it took the committee agitating for some answers that's revealed a much more complex picture. And really just to say, in future, we should, if we can, ensure the authorities we are dealing with are a little bit more forthcoming in respect of issues like this, especially when we're on this kind of precipice where really there's not very much we can do other than note our concerns.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you very much. I agree with the comments that have been made, so I'm not going to repeat them. That's been helpful. Mr. McGregor, I know you're online, just to check if there's anything that you wish to add.
No, nothing really can be other than what I said when the Cabinet Secretary was in, and I think has been summarised fairly well by colleagues. I do obviously have concerns, but I think in balance, and with the safeguards expressed by others, I think I'm happy to note this instrument today and acknowledge the Cabinet Secretary's offer to come back to us if required.
Thanks very much. That's been helpful, members. So just for clarity and to recap, the SSI has been laid under the negative procedure. So this means that there's no requirement for us to endorse the SSI or vote in its favour for it to come into force. The SSI will come into force unless Parliament agrees a motion to annul. However, obviously we've shared some concerns this morning about the provisions in the SSI. So I suggest that the minute of the meeting states that the committee makes no recommendation on the SSI, but notes that some committee members have expressed some concerns about certain provisions of the SSI, and notes that these concerns are set out on the public record in the official report of the meeting. Are we content with that? Thank you very much.
Sorry, Convener, not just the provisions of the SSI, but the nature by which we are being asked to deliberate it.
Okay, thank you very much. So I'd now propose, in light of the discussion that we've had, that we write in due course to the Cabinet Secretary and the Scottish Prison Service to raise additional points, and that we also invite the Cabinet Secretary back to committee to provide further updates on the situation with the provisions of the SSI.
Also write to the Inspectorate?
Write to the Inspectorate, yep, that's absolutely fine. Okay, thank you very much. Okay, thank you very much, members, for that. And I will quickly move on to our final agenda item, which is post-legislative scrutiny of the Control of Dogs Scotland Act 2010. So in this agenda item, I'd like to invite the committee to consider a letter that we received from the Public Audit Committee, and I refer members to paper number 6. The Public Audit Committee's predecessor carried out post-legislative scrutiny of the Control of Dogs Scotland Act of 2010, and it made a series of recommendations for the Scottish Government, appeared to be frustrated with the pace of the Scottish Government's response. So the Session 6 Public Audit Committee has now brought this issue to our attention, to the attention of a number of parliamentary committees, including our own. So we might want to consider whether there is any merit in repeating the post-legislative scrutiny exercise previously carried out by the Session 5 Public Audit and Post-Legislative Scrutiny Committee. Is there anybody who wants to raise any queries about Mr. Green?
Just very briefly, that in the letter from the Public Audit Committee, it notes that the enforcement of the 2010 Act falls under civil law, but the review of the wider dog control legislation currently falls under criminal law. Therefore, it seems appropriate that this committee would have a watching brief over progress in that area, given the legacy paper of the previous committee, to be clear, the previous Public Audit Committee, which was clear that they were frustrated by the pace of the response to the issue, I would see it fit that we raise this issue with the relevant minister, with whom under this, I suspect the Minister for Public Safety or Communities, it's not quite sure is the answer, but in any case, it would be interesting to ask the minister, either in writing or face-to-face, for an update on progress, either to the consultations that they've launched or indeed legislative plans in this area.
Yep, absolutely happy with that. Okay, any other points anybody wants to raise? Can I suggest that we could also ask for an update from the Scottish Government on its plans and whether it intends to take forward any of the recommendations from the Session 5 Public Audit and Post-Legislative Scrutiny Committee that fall within the criminal justice remit. Any comments? Are we happy with that? Perfect. Okay. Okay. Any other comments on the specific content of the letter? No, we happy with that. Okay. So we will write to the committee, and we can also invite any further correspondence from the relevant minister. That's fine. Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, that concludes the public part of the meeting. Our next meeting will be on Wednesday, the 6th of October, when we will begin our budget scrutiny. We'll now move into private session for the final item on our agenda. Thank you.